I'm really happy to announce the next session of the conference. You know, we have a special guest today, which is the mayor of Toronto, John Tory.
Buenas tardes, buenas noches, hola.
Buenas noches and buenas tardes. Yes, Mayor, you are a great champion for all the community in Toronto. And today we have this special occasion when we are talking about the future of the economy post-pandemic that I think is going to be extremely important for the city. So I will pass the word to you at this point to tell us about how you visualize cooperation with Pacific Alliance and post-pandemic. Thank you so much for being here.
Well, I want to begin by thanking you for having me. I'm sorry that I'm not be able to be with you again in person. I think I have been in prior years, at least one, if not more than 1 year. COVID-19 has changed a lot of that, but the City of Toronto has, from the beginning of this event, been a proud supporter of this event, and it's in recognition of what the LATAM startups have done for prosperity and for job creation. And I think that is, you know, was happening before the pandemic. And of course, it's still happening now, albeit that we've all been affected by this. Sigues haciendo un gran trabajo, creando nuevos puestos de trabajo y oportunidades y te regulo por esto. And I am very grateful for everything that you have done to make this a place. You know, I was on a phone call this morning with a Swedish bank. And we want that Swedish bank to set up a software engineering operation in Toronto. And one of the things I was able to say to them for sure, because it's a big concern of theirs, is talent. And I said, well, you know, we have a lot of talent in Toronto. And I said, we have it for two reasons. The first is because of our great system of education. But the second is because of our open system of immigration, which has meant that some of the best and the brightest from Latin America, from Europe, from Asia, all over the world have come here and want to live here. They chose to live here, but it means they're here and that they can be available to companies like that that come to Toronto, because they said the number one consideration that they think about when it comes to where to locate, whether it's a software engineering facility or just an office, is talent, availability of talent. It's hard these days, especially these days, and even in the aftermath of the pandemic, that won't change. And I think what's great about an organization like this is that you're committed to the overall well-being of the Toronto and Canadian and Ontario economy, but that you are focused on an area that for many of you were countries of origin and connections that you have for that reason or other reasons on Latin America, where I think we have done relatively too little if you look at the opportunities that exist as a result of some of the trade arrangements. I mean, Latin America and South America generally were at the forefront of entering into free trade agreements with Canada, agreements plural. You know, for some period of time, it was the only free trade agreements that existed for us beyond the Canada-US free trade agreement in the day when that's what it was called. And so now I just look at it and say, when I look at, I can well remember, and I'm not here to talk politics, but in one of my election campaigns, there was an event held for Latin American young professionals. So it was just young professionals that were invited. And I went into this room and I didn't know exactly how many people I thought I would find when I got there, but there were, you know, 200. People accomplished in every area of life. They were lawyers, they were accountants, they were you know, doctors, they were business people. And it was extraordinary. And I'm not saying that because I was surprised there were that many, but I'm saying that it shows you the richness of the connections that we have here between people of that sort of experience and accomplishment. And now what we really have to do is to sort of forge the relationships with people in the countries of Latin America, Central and South America, to you know, to our mutual benefit, because we know these things can't be one way. They have to benefit too, but we can benefit by either having them come and start an office or forge a relationship or sell a product or have them buy something from us. It can be very useful. We are a city, you know, of newcomers, as you know. Again, we had Newcomer Day this week, and Newcomer Day is a day the City of Toronto sets aside to celebrate and to make sure we're showing support for people who come here. I mentioned again to the astonishment, he didn't know this number and he was astonished, the fellow we were dealing with at the Swedish bank. And I told him that 51% of the people who live in the City of Toronto were born outside of the country. And I think that proved my point to him about how welcoming we are of people who choose to come to Toronto, and that it's been to our immense benefit and blessing that people have come. But it's fine that they're here benefiting us, but I think that there are so many relationships they can help us to forge through language, through common business experience, through country of origin, common country of origin, and a whole bunch of different ways to build up this relationship. And you've continued to help to push us for more and for better. And you've helped us to make sure we have that rich pool of talent. And for that, I thank you. It's important work that this LATAM startup, entity itself does, leave aside the individual businesses that you all represent, which are important to the well-being of the City of Toronto as well. I should tell you before I conclude that I'm filled with hope. It's been a rough experience for all of you, and it's been a rough experience in some respects, although nobody feels sorry for a politician. But, we've had a difficult time in both trying to keep the city running, but also at the same time to manage a pandemic. But there does come a time when you can see that you're turning the corner. I think that in the context of the vaccinations and the vaccines, I think in the context of some of the signs of hope, I see that the companies that have chosen to come and locate here during the pandemic, global companies that have come here, Reddit expanding their operations, Uber setting up a new engineering facility, a whole bunch of well-known global names that have chosen to expand their operations or locate operations here for the first time, like Reddit is doing. And I'm very heartened by that, because they recognize that the things that were in Toronto before the pandemic, namely a diverse, talented workforce, a representation of the world here like you see no other place in the world, like the excellent system of education, like the critical mass of industry, like the healthcare system. I mean, you could go on and on. Quality of life, the foundational values, those things are all still here. And notwithstanding the pandemic, they're still here. And so I'm committed to kind of building us back up, to getting back on the road again. I'm doing these trade missions by Zoom calls these days, which is better than not doing them. But I want to get back on the road. As you may know, one of the trips I had planned just before the pandemic came was a trip to, I think we're going to go to Mexico, Colombia, Panama. There were five countries I think we were going to. And it was something where I've never been to any of those countries before. So I was quite excited about the prospect of going and the opportunity that they represented, learned mostly about from people like yourselves. May I just conclude by saying thank you for believing in your city. Thank you for believing in your adopted country of Canada. Thank you for forging relationships between your adopted country of Canada and your city and the places that you have relationships with, because that will enrich us in an unbelievable way, as I hope it will enrich you, and not just, I mean, in monetary terms, but enrich you generally. And I want to say thank you in particular to Liliana, of course, who has been faithful to invite me, and she's our CEO, of course, at Amex Cap, to Tadashi, to Luis, to Claudia, and to Claudio, because they have all been people who have really contributed to making this something that was kind of a startup itself, wasn't it? And, I saw it in those early days, and now it's something that has, considerably expanded beyond that. So I think we may have time to ask and answer a few questions. I'll do the best that I can. And if there are questions that have to do with the pandemic or anything else that's of interest to you in terms of getting back into business, don't hesitate. Anything you want is fine with me and the time that you have available. And so back to you. Thank you. Muchas gracias.
Mayor, I have to say, just last year we had 45 technology companies actually entering to Canada through Toronto, and that they established, 20 of them established actually business here during the pandemic. So it was pretty amazing. But we have actually Liliana Reyes here for a question for you. Liliana is representing Amex Cap from Mexico, so I'm going to admit her, and she's going to ask directly a question to you. So.
Hi,
there is Liliana.
Thank you, Marianne. It's a pleasure to meet you, Mayor. I am also very optimistic about the near future. And my question is regarding this. As everyone knows, the USMCA came into force in 2020 and seems to open up new economies of the three countries. And for example, a chapter on digital commerce was added. What is your opinion on the way in which entrepreneurs could benefit from this new legal framework? How can we get the best out of it? And beyond this free trade agreement, what strategies can we implement to strengthen businesses and investment among our countries? Thank you.
Well, first of all, thank you for the question, Liliana. I think that if you look at the two principal concerns of the digital services chapter in the new trade agreement, they addressed themselves to two major issues. The first was security, security in the context of security of people's information and respect for that, because we've seen that there have been instances in a digital world where sometimes the protections aren't adequate and people take advantage of that to have access to personal information they shouldn't have access to, and so on. So I think the first part of the chapter in there was meant to address these issues and make sure that the countries, plural, all the countries in USMPTA could work together to protect personal information and to cooperate on security issues in electronic communications. The second purpose of the chapter was to take advantage of expanding online commercial opportunities and make sure that there weren't the barriers put up as between different countries to make it impossible for people, say, who might have been a Latin American-based startup that came to Toronto and wants to sell into the United States. I mean, the whole idea here is that we're supposed to have a big market that is competitive with the European market and competitive with even the Asian market, because if you add up all the people, of course, that live in North, Central, and South America, it's a huge number of people that represent a very substantial market indeed. And so now we have prohibited things that we're good at, quite frankly, prohibited duties from being applied to things that we're very good at, like electronic games, like music, and other kinds of digital products that are transferred across the border. So what that says to me is you can combine the best of all worlds with the talent pool we have here, the undoubted expertise we have here in a creative sense with respect to digital industries and digital productions and animations and games and all kinds of things we do well, and products that are more directed to commerce and fintech and things like that. You can take the talent pool we have here. You can take the good breeding grounds that Toronto represents because of the critical mass of industry to be able to, try those things out on, as it were, and that you'll be much freer to find global markets for those things, at least in the countries covered by the U.S. USCMC. So I think this agreement, look, we had to make some sacrifices, and there are some people who don't like it. That's true of any agreement you're ever going to sign. The original free trade agreement was the subject of furious debate, but I think when you look at it, when all is said and done, after all the years since it was entered into, people would agree that on balance it's been much better for Canada than it did any harm. And I think the same is true of the new trade agreement, that some people, like some of the dairy farmers, are not very happy with it, but in the end, the country as a whole, including cities like Toronto and the digital industries, will be the better for it. And I think then what we've got to do is just go out and sell. And, selling today, especially in the digital space, is actually easier because you don't actually have to get on a plane. Like my trip that I was going to take is kind of the old-fashioned way of doing it. And the way I'm doing it now on the Zoom calls and WebEx calls is the modern way. And I think there's ways in which we can sell our digital expertise, given the freedom from duties across borders without even leaving Toronto. We can use the connections we have. That's back to the networking that the LATAM startups represent for us to a lot of countries that have huge populations and are probably a little behind us in terms of adoption of digital infrastructure. So I hope that answer helps a little bit.
Yes, thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Liliana. And Mayor, we have just two more questions. The next person is Tadashi Takaoka. He's the General Manager of Social Lab. So I'm going to admit him here.
Thank you very much, Miriam, for this opportunity. Hi, Mayor Tori. Thank you very much for this conversation and for this chance to make your question. Social innovation has changed a lot in these times with the pandemic, and the vision of people in power positions is becoming very, very sensitive to those topics. So you talk a little bit about this during your presentation, but how does Toronto see social innovation? What are the opportunities that you see in the future with Latin America now that you have a bigger spectrum of the new world that the pandemic is bringing?
Well, Tadashi, I see it differently now, to be honest, than I did before the pandemic, because before I understood the concept of a triple bottom line and that there could be benefits that could spin off from some of these resources that would go beyond the number of jobs created and the number of dollars of profit earned and so on. And I came to understand that very well, that it was about more than a job. I mean, a job is important, but it was about making sure there was a job created for particular groups of people who have been marginalized or for particular groups of people who needed a bit of an extra support, whether it be people with disabilities, it could be almost anybody. But what I've seen during the pandemic is that if we wanted to get things done in terms of actually meeting some of the challenges we face, I mean, this is a very prosperous, successful country, but there's a lot of people, even within a very prosperous, successful country, who are struggling. And they're struggling for a variety of reasons. In some cases, it's just, when I say just in quotation marks, that they're in poverty and that getting out of poverty is easier said than done. And so I've come to understand, because of the success we've had in targeting our efforts to get to deal with the pandemic, targeting our efforts at vaccine, targeting our efforts at testing, targeting what we did by way of food security, that actually, you know, we're going to have to learn to do better at that and learn to use the ingenuity of the private sector. A lot of the stuff we've done during the pandemic where we provided quality support for people who needed support have been done not by the government. We were the people that facilitated it. We sometimes funded it, but it's been done by, I'll call them ingenious entrepreneurs in the nonprofit sector and in the private sector, where they had ideas. Look at something like this vaccine hunters thing. I mean, it's just an example of something that two people just invented in their spare time. And it literally has helped thousands upon thousands of people who might otherwise not have had any way of knowing how you went about getting a vaccination to get one. And they didn't even want to be paid for it. They did it as a labor of love. Social enterprises are supposed to try and make money, but at the same time create special opportunities for people in need of extra support. So I think that going forward, we've learned some lessons from the pandemic, which says, first of all, pure private sector, as it were, where you're really just trying to achieve one bottom line, is not going to solve every problem. In fact, it may not solve too many. It creates a lot of jobs. Secondly, government can't do everything. And thirdly, that nonprofits have a hugely important partnership role to play. And I think so if you bring all those together, private sector entrepreneurs with a nonprofit partnership that focuses on the social bottom line as opposed to the economic and financial bottom line, we will not only have many more jobs created of enterprises that will be successful by a different measure, but we will also have, I think, answers we've proven can work better when it comes to targeted, locally sourced, locally devised, in many cases, answers for people who are struggling. And so I just think the opportunity for social innovation now is going to be greater when the pandemic comes to an end than it ever was even before. Because I think we realize the old way of doing things, yes, it works to some extent. And you know, you might argue that it's the best system we have, but I think we've seen hints of a system that can be better. And a lot of that revolves around innovation on the social side applied to business and applied to, and by the way, the export opportunities for, you know, social innovation are global. Because again, every country has this challenge of dealing with certain groups that have become marginalized and providing special opportunities for them, but doing it in a business-like way. And so I think the opportunity for us to come up with these enterprises and then export the concept is huge.
Thank you very much, Mayor.
Thank you, Tadashi. And Mayor, our last question comes from Melanie Campbell. She's the CEO of Startup Peel. Melanie should be here. Thank you so much, Mayor, for taking the time for these questions. Hey, Melanie.
Hi, thank you so much. Thank you, Mayor Tory, for joining us. I remember you've joined us in person at previous events at Metro Convention Center. So it's a pleasure to be on here with you again tonight. And I heard that you were saying just pre-pandemic that you were planning to take a trip to the Pacific Alliance to Latin America. And I've been blessed to go with Miriam and with LATAM startups to Colombia and also to Mexico City to represent Canada and talk about innovation. And I love the fact that you're going to be doing that. And I would love to learn a bit more in terms of innovation, innovation centers that are visited there, and to learn how you're looking at maybe envisioning a partnership with them for Toronto and also, you know, for our great city of Toronto, because I've been a resident of Toronto for numerous years. But how are you looking at doing this post-pandemic? If you can share that with us.
Well, when we've traveled before the pandemic, and I'm not sure really the post-pandemic anything changes in terms of what we have the ability to do and what we have the desire to do. And, you know, we have here a lot of incubators and accelerators that are, you know, among the more respected in the world. And so we can export a lot of that expertise in foreign partnerships with either similar bodies in some of the LATAM countries or with academic institutions. The second thing we've done to some success here is we have forged partnerships with the ones that are excellent in other countries, sometimes often through our, you know, the DMZs and the 111s of the world and these kinds of organizations that are some of our most successful accelerators. I believe that we're going to get back to the tried and true formula. I mean, I think what we have to do is expose people in these countries directly. I don't think there's any substitute for kind of face-to-face. And these trips that I take, generally, I take people with me from the private sector. Most of the last trips to Europe and to New York and to London before the pandemic were all with basically tech people. There was a little bit of financial services people, but mostly tech, even the tech side of financial services. So I think what I can do to be helpful is open doors. You know, people will see me in these countries. The accelerators will receive me to show us around. We can take a lot of people there from the universities and from the existing accelerators and so on here, and hopefully forge some partnerships out of that. But it's all, in the end, it's all about people, you know, you know, on these trips, I have inevitably helped some of our Toronto-based companies to meet people in Europe. So I haven't been to South America, but in Europe or in Asia, who they otherwise might not have had a chance to meet, including the United States. So, you know, what I say about these trips is, why am I going to devise my own itinerary for going to Peru or Colombia or any of the countries, Mexico? Because the people who know Peru, Colombia, and Mexico are people who are from Peru, Colombia, and Mexico, or who live there now. And so I would flip the question around and sort of say, look, I'm willing to give up the time. I can't say exactly when it'll be after the pandemic because we got a bit backlogged on traveling. But I'm willing to commit the time as mayor to lead a delegation of businesses. And I'm then going to rely on LATAM startups and so on, organizations like it, to tell me where I should go and who I should see when I get there, and even who I should take with me. You know, which are the businesses, not that just would like to go on a trip, but the ones that will be most beneficial for us to have along. And I found that when I'm out selling us as a place to make movies or a place to locate fintech businesses or a place to, as in the Swedish bank I talked to this morning, to locate a engineering a hub here, that the best people to tell me what we should be asking for are the people who know what they need over there and people who know what they have to export to us over here. And so I'll be relying very much on that. And that's how we put these itineraries together. We don't just make up places that I'd like to go because I've never been there. We go where, you know, you go fishing where the fish are. And we're going to go fishing where we think there are companies that want to come and invest and create jobs in the city of Toronto and form partnerships with our own companies and our academic institutions.
Perfect. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Melanie. Mayor, thank you so much for taking questions. You know, from our guest, I know that Claudio Rojas and Claudia Kriwak are looking at well. Thank you for coming today and for making the time. We are going to continue with the conference for the next conversation with our panelists, and I welcome you to continue watching. But I know your schedule is very busy.
I just can't because I have something else to do at 6:30. So it's going to be more disruptive for me to leave later than now. So I'll say thank you for having me, and all the very best. And I'll look forward to seeing you all maybe in Latin America come when we can travel again.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Mayor.
Thank you so much. Bye. Okay. Bye bye now. Bye.